1920s London. A whole new entertainment industry has sprung up after the First World War. Jazz clubs are in vogue with the bright young things. The Charleston and the Foxtrot have got the nation up on its feet. There's a picture palace on every corner, and sport is more popular than ever before. So where does opera fit into this bright and sparkling modern nightlife scene? Is it a fusty relic of the pre-war era, cast into the shadows by cinema and musical theatre? Some commentators of the day seem to think so, even suggesting it won't survive the decade. But scratch beneath the surface and we find that opera is thriving in the 1920s, sometimes in the most unexpected places. It's attracting large, socially mixed audiences. And it's also finding clever ways of interacting with the very forms of popular culture that might appear to threaten it. Opera going in 1920s London is diverse, vibrant, and heaps of fun. I'm opera historian Alexandra Wilson, and in this programme I'll be stepping into the shoes of a fashionable 1920s flapper and taking you on a journey back in time. We'll be visiting some of the many and varied venues where you could hear opera in the 20s. Some of them were glamorous, some of them seedy. Each location tells a different story, about quirky performance practices, colourful audiences or celebrity singers. So put on your cloche hat or slip into your Oxford brogues and be my guest as I guide you around operatic London, 1920s style. Let's begin at Covent Garden in the early years of the decade. The fruit and vegetable market is thriving, but the opera house itself has an air of shabbiness about it. Frankly, it could do with a facelift. The theatre's only recently reopened. It served as a furniture store during World War I. Opera goers mull around a dated Victorian foyer with heavy curtains and large aspidistras in pots. That is, if the opera is even on tonight, because there are all sorts of other things on the bill. Operas are only performed here for a few months of the year. The rest of the time, Covent Garden plays host to film screenings, charity balls, review shows and pantomimes. So what kind of people might we find here in the 1920s? The audience at Covent Garden has changed a lot since the war. High society is still out in force, but now rubs shoulders with the nouveau riche. Up in the cheap seats, it all depends what the show is. If it's a Wagner night, the gallery's full of earnest middle-class intellectuals. But if Verdi's on the bill, there'll be a noisy crowd of Soho Italians. Tiaras and jewels are still de rigueur in the stalls and circle for gala performances in the 1920s, but on an ordinary night, the dress code is changing. It's becoming a much more democratic place. But Dame Nellie Melba, the grande dame of the pre-war era, isn't impressed. Here she recalls performing La Bohème for the reopening of Covent Garden after the First World War.
It was that night at Covent Garden which made me realise the full extent to which London had changed. Though there was as much, if not more, enthusiasm than before, there was so little of the old brilliance. Can you imagine, in the old days, men walking into Covent Garden on Melbourne night or any other night and sitting in the stalls in shabby tweed coats? Yes, that's what I saw on this night, and though I have no objection to brown tweed coats or to shabbiness, I could not help feeling a sensation almost of resentment that men who could afford to pay for stalls could not also afford to wear the proper clothes.
Artistically too, there's a sense that 1920s Covent Garden hasn't yet recovered its pre-war prestige. In the 1900s, it vied with New York as the international capital of opera. but the creme de la creme of foreign singers left before the war and haven't yet returned. Performance standards here in the 20s are, well, let's say far from ideal. It's even considered normal for principals to sing in several different languages in the same show. If the performance is in English, it's hard to persuade a star singer to relearn their part, so they sing it in Italian. Or in the case of Joseph Hislop as Pinkerton in Madame a Butterfly, Swedish. The audience don't seem to care, but the critics find these so-called polyglot performances frustrating. Here's the musical standard in 1923.
There have been performances of opera in which more than one language has been sung. That is to say, one singer giving a part in one language and the rest in another language. There have even been plays performed in this way. Imagine Faust with a French Marguerite, a German Mephisto, an Italian Faust and an English chorus all singing in their native languages. For decades we bore with German and Italian opera, but now, in any case, let us have it all in one language. Let us understand all or nothing.
Dr. Paul Rodmell, head of music at the University of Birmingham, has been looking into the strange practice of polyglot performances. It was happening at Covent Garden even earlier than the 1920s.
As far as we can see, it started around about 1890. For several decades prior to that, Covent Garden had really been the home of Italian opera. And by Italian opera, I don't mean the origin of the repertory, I mean the language of the performance. Everything, but everything, was translated into Italian. So you didn't go and see The Flying Dutchman, you went to see L'Olandese Donato. But around about 1890, the then manager of Covent Garden, Augustus Harris, decided to try and start performing operas in the original language. And he started with a performance of Gounod's Romeo and Juliet. The problem was that the casts of the operas, the stars and the choruses, often didn't know the original language. They'd only been trained in one version. And this was at a time when rehearsals were very short and often very disorganised. And so what you got in quite a few instances was that the chorus in particular would only know the Italian version that they were used to. And they would keep going in Italian while the principals would sing in French or German, even occasionally in English. And if you had to make a very rapid substitution of a principal singer, then the substitute might only know one version. So there's a recorded example of somebody singing, I think, a Gounod opera in French, whilst the rest of the company were performing it in Italian. And sometimes the chorus didn't even sing in the same language themselves. Different people sang in different languages, according to what they knew.
Right, onwards with our 1920s whistle-stop tour of operatic London. It's a short walk through Leicester Square to my next venue. This is a rather more unexpected place to find opera. We're at the corner of Coventry Street and Rupert Street in the buzzing heart of the West End. As a 1920s flapper, what's drawn me here is the Lion's Corner House, a massive multi-storey restaurant. It's a bit of a one-stop shop. You'll also find a shoe-shining parlour here and a theatre booking office. Music is also very much on the menu. This branch of the Corner House chain employs several jazz bands, and diners are also entertained by accordionists or gypsy violinists. But in the autumn of 1923, the Corner House is trying something different. It's invited the Carl Rosa Opera Company to perform in its third floor restaurant on a specially constructed stage. The Carl Rosa is a touring company which travels to theatres up and down the land. It has several troupes on the road at once, putting on cheap and cheerful performances of popular operas in English. At the Lions, 6 singers and 16 instrumentalists are performing half-hour operatic excerpts in costume, once in the afternoon and twice at night. The scenes come from Tosca, La Traviata and Aida, but also from Lohengrin. Wagner's works are hugely popular in the 1920s. The baritone from the troupe, a Mr. Kingsley Lark, tells a reporter that neither the smoke nor the passing waitresses distract the singers. During the 1920s, the Lions' corner houses attract a mixed cosmopolitan clientele. Clerks, typists and shopgirls come here. So do families from the suburbs for a night up west. And the Coventry Street branch is a particular meeting place for Soho Jews and gay men. It's a crowd with diverse musical tastes, happy to listen to a bit of this and a bit of that. So putting opera and jazz side by side isn't as unexpected as you might think. The Coventry Street Lions Corner House is still a bustling cafe. A good place to meet Catherine Tackley, Head of Music at the University of Liverpool, to find out more about how opera and jazz interacted during the 20s.
I think it's interesting because we think about those two genres today perhaps as being quite separate and in their own ways quite niche, but at this point in time it wouldn't have felt unusual, I suspect, to have those two forms of entertainment operating under the same roof. Certainly when jazz came along and ragtime and other forms of American popular music and entertainment, they were kind of presented side by side, and that seems to be the same sort of way in which they were encountered here in the Corner House.
And there were jazz operas, weren't there? Would they have been well known at this time?
There were some jazz operas. For example, Scott Joplin had written an opera by this point. And then there were some later examples from the Weimar Republic. The ones that might have been known by this point were perhaps Gershwin's early efforts. And a couple of years later, after this Coventry Street venue opened, Gershwin had appeared here in London, and he'd written an article for the Radio Times where he talked about his aspirations towards writing a jazz opera, which of course was to become Porgy and Bess. Certainly there was this very real sense that there was an overlap between jazz and classical music, and that was much debated around the time.
And how about operatic tunes being incorporated into popular songs? There were rags, weren't there, that talked about opera?
Yeah, absolutely. I think just as later on musical theatre provided that huge American songbook of jazz standards that musicians still love to improvise over, at the time they were always looking for sources to base their playing and their improvisations on. So we know, for example, particularly in the city of New Orleans, it actually had a very strong operatic tradition, that the musicians there were familiar with opera and would quite frequently weave it into their improvisations. And other musicians such as Sidney Bechet were familiar with that. Sidney Bechet was actually a visitor here in the 1920s, round about the time of the Corner House, in fact. And we know from testimony that he improvised an obbligato over a Madame Butterfly aria, for instance. So this repertoire was known to jazz musicians and quite frequently cropped up either as a basis for whole-scale numbers or perhaps quoting it in their improvisations.
Onwards from Leicester Square to South Kensington now to our next destination. In the 1920s, the Albert Hall hosts everything from boxing matches to brass bands, but it's also the habitat of a much maligned operatic type, the celebrity singer. In all honesty, the hall has become the butt of jokes. the last chance saloon of the fading star who refuses to retire. Here's Edward Dent, 1920s music critic and Cambridge Don, writing in the Illustrated London News in 1922.
To serious lovers of music, it is almost always a matter of regret when famous singers or players reach that point in their career when they give concerts in the Albert Hall. No doubt it is quite possible for a great artist to remain a great artist when singing in that place, though there are probably many people who would deny this altogether.
But in the autumn of 1924, someone new and exciting is on the bill. Amelita Gallicherchi is an Italian-American soprano and the biggest recording star of the moment. She hasn't been to Britain before, her voice on the gramophone, and her concerts at the Albert Hall have sold out 8 months in advance. The hype is intense. Gallicherchi is not merely a new star, but a new type of star, and she draws a new crowd. The pick-and-mix programme Gallicherchi performs in 1924 is a real crowd-pleaser. First, there are the coloratura arias. The lullaby from Act 1 of Meyerbeer's Dinora is her calling card, and she performs not one but two mad scenes, which allow her to show off her vocal pyrotechnics. Gallicherchi's performance at the Albert Hall in 1924 isn't all about opera. There are also American popular songs like Swanee River and ballads like Home Sweet Home, a perennial favourite with prima donnas and audience members alike. Soprano Ellen Manahan Thomas enjoys putting varied programmes together herself and has some thoughts on Gallicherchi's pick-and-mix programme.
It is a fascinating selection of songs. I mean, it's always questionable whether it's worth doing wonderful big arias like the Lucia mad scene without an orchestra, because really the effectiveness of both singer and accompaniment is slightly lost. But equally, if you're looking at Anne Sylvia or that beautiful 1920s hit Home Sweet Home, I mean, that really is a song, and you're looking for your Wigmore Hall type acoustic for that. I think in the end, she probably wanted to win over her fans. She wanted to give a concert, a performance. You know, this is me on a plate. This is what I like singing. This is what you like to hear me singing. She really was stretching herself with stuff from Pergolesi up to 20th century stuff. But I think she was just looking to go to the hearts of the crowds. This was her chance, after all. This is her coming all the way to Britain to give herself her big moment.
Gallicherchi's recital in 1924 also includes songs like Henry Rowley Bishop's Pretty Mockingbird, which ends with an extended cadenza of cheeping and chirruping. As far as the critics are concerned, such music is beyond the pale, and Gallicherchi little better than a performing dog at the circus. The conoscenti can't bear star sopranos. They think they're overpaid, overexposed, and not really interested in art. But the crowd laps it up. There's no orchestra for a concert like this, it's just Gallicherchi, a tiny figure in white, and her husband Homer Samuels at the piano. Ellen Manahan Thomas has sung at the Albert Hall and has a good insight into what it must have been like for Gallicherchi that night.
It must have been the most extraordinary experience to step out on that stage, which we can see from pictures was already packed with audience. And even on the stage, not to mention the 5,000-seater auditorium, there are people packed in. That makes a big difference to the acoustic, because don't forget, this is pre-1969 and those lovely flying saucers of acoustic. It was pretty echoey, but the people did dampen it quite a lot. Trying to get the balance in the Albert Hall is hard at the best of times. I've sung there with full orchestra, I've sung there with tiny baroque orchestra, and I've sung it totally unaccompanied. And I think you just have to have your wits about you. There's something very special, very magical about the place, but the best atmosphere in the world can't really change the acoustics of it, so I think she was asking a lot of herself.
Unfortunately for Galli-Curci, reports of her concert in 1924 are mixed. The tabloid press is quick to hail it as a triumph, but a note of doubt creeps into the serious reviews, the Musical Times.
One is surprised to find so many thousands run to go and hear the singer. After all, the very flower of her art is to be got from the pick of her gramophone records. She could not possibly sing better at the Albert Hall than she has done in the recording room. She may, conceivably, sing less well. And in fact, she seems to have done so.
Poor Galli-Curci. Listeners in the 1920s have little understanding about how the recording process works. They don't realise that recordings are the product of multiple takes, that a live performance can't hope to match the perfect studio product. And in Galli-Curci's case, the hype that allowed her to sell so many tickets has ensured that her fall is all the greater. Onwards now to a theatre where the star system doesn't get a look in. We've crossed over to the south bank of the Thames, to the Old Vic near Waterloo Station. In the 1920s, this is the London home of popular opera. The programme here alternates between operas in English and Shakespeare. Opera productions are put on a shoestring and without much rehearsal. The singers are all British, and everything is sung in translation. Here's Frank Mullings singing On With the Motley from Pagliacci in the mid-1920s. Singing in English is that the translations aren't always very good. In fact, sometimes they're ludicrous. Here's the Musical Times in 1928 on the problem of singing Carmen in English.
In The Waterloo Road, the story of a soft-hearted young soldier who comes to grief through falling to a vixen's fascination might be credible enough. It is removed to a queer pinchbeck and sawdust world by an English such as has never been spoken by anyone and never written by anyone but libretto translators. The lines simply bristle with artificialities and inversions. Come back and go back are banned colloquialisms. It is always return. I soon shall return, coos Michaela. Return is a word which in real life we address to nobody but the ticket clerk at the station. Carmen, the vixen of the gutter and the hedgerow, wants to say to Jose, what are you staring at now? She has to sacrifice half the effect she has been at pains to make with her pretty wickedness by coming out with, "At what dost thou now gaze?"
The atmosphere at the Old Vic in the 1920s is overwhelmingly one of fun. The audience is mainly working class, and nobody wears evening dress. The composer Ethel Smythe calls the Old Vic patrons the most delightful audience in the world, and they certainly take their music seriously. There's a maxim that while people go to Covent Garden to hear Melba, they go to the Old Vic to hear the opera. The Old Vic is one of London's most famous theatres, but Paul Rodmell has been researching its less well-known history as a venue for opera.
There's been a theatre here now for almost 200 years, but the really significant date is around about 1880, when the theatre was taken over by a woman called Emma Cons, and I suppose she was what we would now call a bit of a liberal do-gooder. She was later the first female alderman on London County Council. She was also quite an important suffragist. But here at the Old Vic, what she did was founded a temperance music hall in order to encourage the local working classes to come into the theatre, but not obviously to drink alcohol. And this was developed alongside a programme of entertainment which included lectures, performances of Shakespeare, and around about 1900, we think, they started doing operatic recitals in costume of very condensed versions of operas. And certainly by about 1912, these had developed into full-length performances. Reviewers often comment on the attentiveness, positivity, and enthusiasm of the audience, quite often in contrast to Covent Garden, where they think people are rather too interested in the social aspect of the performance. And the other thing that they pick up on, of course, is the cheapness of the prices. Tuppence to 2 shillings, which is a real bargain by anybody's measure.
See a lot of crowd-pleasing operas at the Old Vic by the 20s. Cav and Pag are firm favourites, but you can also hear rarities here, operas that have fallen out of fashion. This is the only place in town where you'll catch a work like Donizetti's La Fille du Régiment, and even the operas of Mozart aren't that well known in 1920s Britain. But at the Old Vic, there's an annual Mozart festival, and the theatre has roped in Cambridge academic Edward Dent to provide new English translations that are a cut above the norm. There's a regular repertory cast of British singers, so the audience feels as though it knows them personally and greets them with cheers when they come on the stage. Here's the Musical Times in 1924 on the Old Vic's Marriage of Figaro.
Mr. Sumner Austin, the life and soul of the festival, was quite admirable as Figaro and acted with the most infectious high spirits. He gave us the accustomed thrill in Non più andrai and fairly brought the house down. How Mozart would love the way the applause at the Old Vic continually bubbles up, to the annoyance of highbrows who object to clapping till the music is over.
In search of more Mozart now, and heading northeast to the Isle of Dogs. If we imagine ourselves back into the 20s, this densely packed working class residential area is busy and bustling. Cargo ships constantly ply up and down the Thames, together with the odd luxury cruise liner. I'm standing outside a modern primary school. In our parallel world of the 1920s, there's a school here too, but in a rather more imposing Victorian building, the Glengall Road Elementary School. And it's here that a fascinating experiment is taking place. The school's music teacher during the 20s is a Mr. Charles T. Smith. He's devised an entire manifesto for educating children from working class families. He calls it the School of Life. It's about inspiring the pupils by introducing them to all of human civilization, the Greeks, the Renaissance, Chekhov and Shakespeare. But because Mr. Smith teaches music, opera is at the heart of this ambitious scheme. In 1920, he stages a complete production of The Magic Flute, rearranging the parts to suit children's voices and using a piano in place of an orchestra. And 13-year-old boys take on all the principal roles, and the other pupils muck in making props and costumes. The children learn the music by singing along to gramophone records. Astonishingly, Smith teaches all the music to everyone so they can take each other's parts if anyone is unwell. There are difficulties to be overcome in this bold 1920s project, but they're not the ones we might expect. The boys singing Pamina and the Queen of the Night are quarantined at home with sick relatives and can't rehearse. But they manage to learn their music faultlessly, despite neither having a piano. And then on one of the performance nights, the school heating breaks down, in January, in an era of notorious peace supers. But the show goes on anyway. Smith takes serious music seriously and has high expectations of what children can achieve.
Say love only that makes the world go round. I should not feel so lonely had I a sweetheart found. Had I a sweetheart found. Had I a sweetheart found. Then life would be nothing but play. Treasure, no need to learn wisdom in there, 'twere wisdom enough and to spare. I'd envy no monarch his treasure, no need to learn wisdom in there, 'twere wisdom enough and to spare, enough and to spare, enough and to spare.
Modern-day schoolboy James Outram recreates what the 1920 performance might have sounded like. We've gone back in time to the Isle of Dogs in the 1920s, where music teacher Charles T. Smith is putting on complete opera productions with his pupils. Smith is a man with contacts, and he invites the leading critics along. The show gets rave reviews, with some arguing that so-called schoolboy opera is the way of the future. Ernest Newman of The Observer.
I went to hear these little fellows, boys of 12 and 13, do the magic flute in the parish rooms. The results were really extraordinary. One does not expect skilled voice production in these quarters, but the little fellows had an amazing knowledge of their music and an excellent idea of the opera. The great favourite with the audience was, of course, the Papageno. This young person had evidently been to the pictures and seen funny men. I had the feeling that, after all, this was very much like what the fun of the magic flute must have been at first. Very much what that joker, Schikaneder, intended it to be.
But Smith is most interested in the impact of the experiment on the boys themselves, their families and the local community. The experience is truly a transformative one. Boys who are normally shy enter their parts with gusto, and children previously overlooked for having no particular talent come out of their shells. Smith argues that they enter into their parts so intensely simply because they're happy. Their brush with opera even has the capacity to turn lives around. Smith's concerned about a former pupil who's turned to shoplifting and seems destined for a life in and out of prison. But another boy who's seen him recently has a surprising story to tell.
Yes, sir. He's getting on fine. His father came home drunk the other night and knocked his mother about, so he took his father out into the garden and gave him a jolly good hiding. And yesterday, he and his chums had a half a day off as the works closed down, and I met them as I was coming to school, going to the Beecham Opera to hear E. Pagliacci and Cavalleria Rusticana.
Mm-hmm. parents are astonished at the transformation in their sons, and Smith hopes that whole families will come to love opera. This is opera for all, and it's about building the audiences of the future. The key to it is making opera seem like something normal, just another part of everyday life. Off to Glengall Grove in the Isle of Dogs now to meet Michael Volpe, General Director of Opera Holland Park. He's a passionate advocate of getting children hooked on opera early and a big fan of Mr. Smith's methods.
It seems extraordinary now, but there was a time when a lot of schools did do this kind of thing, and it needed people like Mr. Smith to do it. And he didn't accept any excuses or qualifications. He said, this is Mozart, these are children with voices and brains, and they should be doing it. And I think that's about as simple as it should be, really. Well, I think we've definitely overcomplicate this issue. And I think, as you probably know, I think kids from the age of five should spend an hour a week compulsorily listening to and talking about and writing about the classical arts, theatre, opera, dance, whatever it might be, and listening to it. You know, my school did Die Freischütz, which even now as a professional opera company, we're scared stiff of giving a go to, because it's such a difficult, challenging piece. And I think, you know, you need to be reasonable, but in Smith's story, I think it just shows you the capacity that young people have for learning and participating in music. Sure, there's a big argument around these kids who go on television and ape opera stars and sing Ness and Dorma, and, you know, which is quite damaging for their voices if they do it too much. But, you know, if you're 10, 11, 12, 13, there are ways to teach kids to sing things that won't damage their voices, and which just means they're singing the melodies and the notes. You know, a 12-year-old boy might have a really good stab at the Queen of Night aria, but, you know, no one's looking for Royal Opera House standards when we do this.
We're back on the road again now, heading north to the heart of the East End. This is the Stoke Newington Road, hipsterville in 2017, but rather a different place almost a century ago. We're standing in front of a 1960s tower block, but on our 1920s journey there's an enormous theatre here, the Alexandra, which takes up an entire block. It's a multi-purpose venue built in the late Victorian era by Frank Matcham, architect of the London Coliseum. Variety acts and film screenings dominate the bill, but opera pops up now and then. January 1926, the O'Mara Touring Opera Company at the Alexandra Theatre, performing popular box office hits like Faust and Michael William Balfe's The Bohemian Girl. The company packs in the crowds. There's a really enthusiastic working-class audience for opera in the East End. But the singers are exhausted, and here's why. For a start, they have to sing in an auditorium that's drafty, misty, and filled with tobacco smoke. But even worse, a single cast has to sing two performances a night, back to back. Take, for example, the weekly schedule for the lead tenor, a certain Furness Williams. He sings the leading roles in Faust twice on Tuesday, in Rigoletto twice on Wednesday, in The Bohemian Girl twice on Thursday, and in The Lily of Killarney twice on Saturday. The O'Mara Company are not only singing in a variety hall in the 20s, but they're borrowing performance practices from variety as well. The twice-nightly system was wheeled out across the Moss-Stoll empire of music halls from the late 1890s.
I have got a sweetie known as Susie. In the words of Shakespeare, she's a wow. Oh, all of you may know her too. I'd like to shout right now.
I'm heading to the site of the old Alexandra Theatre to meet Dr. Oliver Double, author of the book Britain Had Talent, a history of variety theatre which explores the twice-nightly system.
essentially Victorian Music Hall, which started in the 1850s, roughly speaking. Essentially, it started as tavern-based entertainment. So the shows they put on would be very long. I mean, they might run to 3 or 4 hours. And the idea was that you wouldn't necessarily go for the entire show. It was like partly a show, partly a night out with friends for a drink. A huge amount of the money that was made was from the license trade, from what they called the wet money. One of the objections to Music Hall was that it was a place of iniquity where people got drunk and so on. So it became increasingly difficult to actually have a bar within the auditorium. Once you separate the auditorium from the place where you can buy drink, the wet money goes down. So you need to find another way of making money. Lots of different theatre proprietors were trying out having a shorter, tighter show, and you run it twice a night. And that way you can make twice the amount of ticket revenue, essentially, because you get twice the number of people watching the show.
Well, we tend, rightly or wrongly, to think of Music Hall as a rather lowbrow form of entertainment, but there was actually quite a lot of high culture, so-called, on the bill, wasn't there?
Yeah, absolutely. I mean, I think one of the things that's worth bearing in mind is that Music Hall in the 19th century started out as being small entrepreneurs. But gradually, as the 19th century reached its final decades, it would tend to be more chains. So people like Richard Thornton, H.E. Moss, Oswald Stoll, collecting lots of theatres. And what they wanted to do was to purify it, to make it respectable, to attract women, not just work-class men, and also to attract middle-class audience members. One of the things they would do would be to sort of flaunt their cultural value by bringing in, for example, Shakespearean actors to come and do a speech from Julius Caesar. That happened at the Palladium. Or bringing in the Thomas Beecham Opera Company. There was a music hall critic, W.R. Titterton, who actually talked about the savages invading the stage of variety in relation to sort of actors and opera singers appearing in variety. I think it wasn't always actually an easy mix. There was a certain sort of cultural clash between the two.
We're heading back to our starting point now and flashing forward by a few years to the end of the 1920s. Things are on the up at Covent Garden. London is starting to rival New York again and attract the biggest international names in opera. The celebrated bass Chaliapin is back for the first time since the war. Maria Yaritsa, Lotte Lehmann and Rosa Poncel are the new star sopranos. Enthusiastic fans will camp out overnight to hear their favourite singer. Production standards are improving to the level of the Edwardian Golden Age, and the first operatic subsidy is just around the corner in the early 1930s. So let's step back to the present day now and reflect from a distance on the operatic life of 1920s London. Critics may have been gloomy about the state of operatic culture, but from our perspective it would seem that there was much to celebrate. Opera wasn't a niche form of elite entertainment, but something for everyone. Office boys and factory workers listened to operatic hits on the gramophone and the wireless and whistled them in the street. Arias by Bizet and Puccini were sung in cinemas to accompany films. Prima donnas appeared on the front page of the tabloids and endorsed face creams. Opera not only rubbed shoulders with popular culture, but in many senses was popular culture.